Though the children of Ocaña are suitably impressed by the millionaire and his entourage, no one's eyes shine brighter than Richard Branson's.
Feliz Año Nuevo!
Richard Branson is here to learn how to fly a hot air balloon and then to attempt the first ever crossing of the Atlantic in one. The commercial spin-offs of Branson and Virgin could be enormous. So could the cost. He could be killed. He plans to go in June. For the moment, the enterprise is a secret one. It's called Project Yankee.
Adios, hija!
Look down from in high places. Lift off the ground. Without a sound yet. The wind it pulls, the sky gets close, yeah. Could we get much higher? Could we get much lighter? Navigator to heaven.
That's great judgment. I was convinced we were going to hit it. I don't know. My heart must be weakening.
I've been very lucky in that I've had a teacher who bullied when bullying was necessary. Because I think if you're going to learn to fly anything, there are going to be moments where you're going to want to have been shouted at when you've made mistakes so that you can react quickly. You know, we've almost come to blows on occasions.
I don't think you need me anymore. That's excellent judgment.
But I haven't actually had to do what I was told since I was about 15 when I left school, so it's quite a strange sensation actually having somebody shouting at you for 3 days, and I've just had to get used to it.
I don't think they've ever seen a hot air balloon before. I like their comments, have you come from England?
The man bearing a bewildering resemblance to Richard Branson is professional balloonist Robin Batchelor. He's on the left, hired to get Branson through the flying hours necessary to qualify him for a ballooning pilot's license.
Give yourself a target. There's a track. Let's bash onto the, somewhere between those two towns then.
I think this is the most beautiful sight I've seen in all my life.
Love it.
Richard Branson won't be making the Atlantic attempt on his own. Ballooning veteran and former Swedish Air Force engineer Per Lindstrand is going too. Lindstrand owns the Thunder and Colt balloon factory in the north of England, and he's going to make the Atlantic Flyer, as it will be called, the largest balloon ever built, capable of swallowing whole one of Branson's own jumbo jets. Indeed, the whole thing was Lindstrand's idea.
I had, at that time, supplied them with two hot air balloons for advertising. The first one was this intersected jumbo balloon. The other one was a convention balloon with an airline seat flying underneath it. At that time, I was working on this idea, which I had been doing for several years, and I reached a state where it was time to talk to a potential sponsor, a client, about it. And they just happened to see me working at it at the time, and obviously realized this is it.
Before actually, you know, saying yes, I obviously spent a lot of time asking him an awful lot of questions because I enjoy life, and had no wish to depart from it.
Yet the first of his well-documented and much ballyhooed bids to make the fastest sea crossing of the Atlantic very nearly did end in disaster when the boat ploughed into some floating debris, broke up and sank. That was in 1985.
I think if you're going to go for any world record, you have to accept that there is a possibility that you can get killed. If you're going to be the first to attempt anything, you've got to accept a certain amount of risks.
How does your girlfriend feel about that, your family?
I think she'd rather I didn't go. I mean, I was just reading a report last night of the 3 or 4 hours after Challenger sank. My girlfriend was in hospital having a baby and how they tried to keep it away from them. That was an emotional document to read. One could quite rightly argue that one shouldn't have to put one's family through risks like that. But at the same time, I think that, you know, that she knew what sort of person I was when we got together.
Determined not to be beaten, he built another boat the following year. This time he lopped more than 2 hours off the American-held record. A record design, said the Americans, for ocean liners, which is why they weren't going to hand the blue riband over to a speedboat. Branson should have worried. He was buzzing, and Virgin's profile was never higher. 3 years earlier, Per Lindstrand was after records of his own, to fly higher in a balloon, over 55,000 feet, than anyone had gone before. He'd be crammed into a pressurized capsule, seen here undergoing sea rescue trials. The balloon envelope, as it's called, would be the largest to date, and Lindstrand named his craft SkyQuest.
One similarity between the SkyQuest and this program is the size of the envelope. At the time, we were using a 1.6 million cubic foot envelope. This time, it's a 2.5 million. The particular shape of that 1.6 million was such that it was very, very hard to handle. And the least bit of wind, and it has a minus of its own. I just got caught in the rope, was pulled up. I wasn't supposed to be there. I walked past two of the girls who were crying for help because they were entangled in fabric as wind got up, and I ran in to cut them loose, and my hand just got stuck in a piece of rope, and the sheer force of the wind just threw me up in the air.
Lindstrand fell 30 feet and broke his arm. The balloon was torn to shreds in the wind.
The inflation is no doubt the most difficult, the whole operation. And at that time, we were inflating a balloon of very different shape, optimized for climb and descent, and therefore a lot more difficult to inflate.
Like Branson, Lindstrand tried again. The wind struck again, and SkyQuest 2 drifted away without a soul on board. So why go now for a more difficult record like the Atlantic?
The Atlantic has always been the travel between the two major continents on Earth. There's also a fairly violent weather pattern compared to the Pacific, which is very, very predictable. And it can also reward you with a high speed of the weather pattern if you follow the right one. And it's always been the one to challenge, the unpredictable one.
Gas balloon we're flying for hundreds of hours in the 1920s.
A gas balloon can almost circumnavigate the Earth as it is receiving its lift from a captive gas and needs no replenishing to do so.
Engine-driven Zeppelins filled with hydrogen gas regularly flew non-stop across the Atlantic, but it wasn't until 1958 that any serious attempt was made in an unpowered gas balloon. Colin Moody and his family flew 1,200 miles east to west using the southern trade winds before ditching in their eminently practical gondola, rowing the rest of the way to Barbados. From now on, everyone who was to try the crossing flew west to east to take advantage of the prevailing North Atlantic winds. In 1970, British balloonist Malcolm Brighton and two others set off from North America. They came down in a storm off Newfoundland. They were never seen again. In 1973, Bobby Sparks was lucky to escape with his life when a violent storm brought him down, again near Newfoundland.
Whatever the storm wanted to do with me, that's what it did. It was struck by lightning, or lightning discharged near the balloon about 45 or 50 times. It vulcanized the rip panel in the balloon so that I could not deflate it when I landed the next morning. Set the boat on fire, and for my own point of view, after a while, you get used to the lightning. The problem was I was dying from hypothermia. I was so cold and so weak that I was lying on the bottom of my boat and I could not turn over or get up. I dropped 300 pounds of weight and I should have gone up like a rocket, but I went down like a rock. It was totally out of control. Whatever the wind and the storm wanted to do, that's what the balloon and I did.
The next to try the following year was Thomas Gatch.
10 plastic balloons were filled with helium gas and ready to carry Thomas Gatch on an attempt to cross the Atlantic. Gatch, a former Army officer, said his main worry was passing airplanes. If all goes well, Gatch expects to arrive in Spain sometime Thursday.
He never made it. The Atlantic claimed him in mid-ocean. 4 attempts followed in the next 3 years. In all, 5 balloonists died. Yet still they set out. In 1977, Maxie Anderson and Ben Abruzzo flew in Double Eagle, and still they came down.
When we were asked before we left why we were going to make this flight, we said, why not? Well, I say now, I can tell you why not. You got to be crazy.
Crazy or not, they did try again, but not before a British pair, Don Cameron and Christopher Davy, became the most successful nearly men in the business, ditching, becalmed, just 100 miles from France.
It was extremely disappointing because we did hope until the very last that we could pull the fat out of the fire. We've undoubtedly failed, but we have succeeded more than anyone else who's attempted this has.
That greater success stood for just 2 weeks before the Americans, Abruzzo and Anderson, with a third man, Larry Newman, finally went all the way, landing in a wheat field 50 miles from Paris. They went by plane to London to commiserate with Cameron and Davy and recognize publicly how lucky they were.
Flying the Atlantic in a balloon is just about impossible. It borders on it.
Well, as they proved, it could be done, but only in a gas-filled balloon. What many balloonists have felt up to now really was impossible, and this is what Richard Branson's trying to do, is to cross the Atlantic in a hot air balloon. Impossible because the weight of all the fuel needed to produce the hot air would need a balloon to support it so vast as to be unrealistic.
A hot air balloon today has a typical endurance of 4 or 5 hours, and the longest we've flown today is about 30 hours. A transatlantic hot air balloon flight has only recently been made possible by research into solar technology, which came into light after the first energy crisis, of course, in 73. We suddenly realized the sun is an immense source of heating. And by inviting the sun into the balloon, but not letting the heat out again, we can actually achieve a flight across the Atlantic. Richard is doing incredibly well, considering that he had no previous experience of ballooning. He's shown every inclination towards achieving the required level of training. And in this case, I think the big thing is he's prepared to give the time necessary to do it. He's obviously an extremely busy person.
Per Lindstrom's balloon factory and a regular meeting of the Project Yankee support team. One of the problems, what to do if the capsule falls in the sea. Project manager Tom Barrow.
We discussed earlier the use of empty fuel cells as flotation devices. There's no reason to realize that the capsule in the water is going to behave any different than a child's beach ball in a hurricane.
Barrow has built a full-size mock-up of the transatlantic capsule, which he uses to apportion the limited space for both pilots and their equipment. The real capsule will be pressurized just like a plane.
This is the first ever sustained balloon flight in a pressurized capsule. And the reason for pressurization is so that we can go higher. And higher is better for the Atlantic crossing for a couple of different reasons. Speed and direction are in your favor, but really it allows you to fly above most of the weather systems.
How do you steer it?
Well, you can't steer it. You simply go up and down to change wind currents, and that would produce a change in direction. But the balloon does not move against the wind, and so it's unsteerable virtually. You don't have the degree of control that you would in an ordinary balloon anyway, because of the sheer size of the envelope. We're talking about an enormous envelope overhead. The opening at the bottom of the balloon is just about big enough to park a London bus in. That's the smallest part of the balloon. That's the hole at the very bottom.
town comes out and all the kids come out and, you know, tremendous excitement. I haven't heard an English voice, and nothing against the English, but to have a week in a remote part of Spain where you're coming in low, everybody here I think works on the farms. Instead of saying get away from my farm, they're pointing desperately for you to come and land on their new crop or on their tractor.
As Richard Branson builds up his flying hours, Per Lindstrand, chased by his recovery crew, climbs to find the thinner atmosphere he needs to test the burners. Burners which will need to function, come the crossing, at 40,000 feet for up to 5 days.
The difference between burning at 35,000 feet against sea level is that 35,000 feet, the density of air is down to a third, and the burner will have to function deprived of two-thirds of his normal oxygen. At that altitude, you produce a vapor trail in the very same manner as an airliner would do. And suddenly you're engulfed in ice crystals raining all over you.
Retreat to base. I'm down by the cafeteria at 301, looking at Pear's vapor trail up there. It's been going on for a while now. I think it's probably about 35,000 feet just now.
Well, it's quite an exhilarating feeling to stand in an open basket looking down on airliners beneath you. Most of the airliners are around 35,000 feet, and then sitting at 39,000 looking down on the jumbos gives you a bit that feeling in the stomach.
I think your first solo flight in anything is a mixture of something which is a bit magnificent and a bit awe-inspiring. I don't think learning to fly a small plane will have anywhere near the same excitement or exhilaration as ballooning. First of all, I had about an hour to take in the beauty of ballooning and knew that I had plenty of fuel for about an hour and a half. It is a magnificent feeling just being up there all on your own with the most fabulous views and the peace and the quiet. You're going exactly the same speed as the wind, and you don't get the sensation of wind hitting you in the face at any great speed. But then a moment comes when you have to land, and on my solo flight the wind had picked up and I realised I was crossing the ground at quite a rapid speed.
Entirely. Good!
So I came in for rather a dramatic landing.
Try to avoid the dark for either the bailout or the landing.
We're counting on you evaluating the
to test the systems on the full-size capsule. Tom Barrow has built a smaller but fully practical version. It will be pressurized, room only for one, and Lindstrom will fly it in Spain at up to 45,000 feet.
Flags dropped a bit, I think.
What was
the weather today?
The chart is quite interesting. We're certainly looking for the improvements, but the high is moving up from the Azores.
I think it might have dropped about 10, 15 knots. Do you think we should have a try?
It's worth trying, for sure.
5 minutes?
Yeah.
10 minutes?
Okay.
All right, lovely. It's quite a big high, although it's pushed away a little bit. But we've still got it down to about 15 knots, 10 knots.
Nice in the Canaries.
Yes, it's lovely, isn't it?
with the small payload and the large balloon we have, the solar heating is so strong that the computer forecasts we will get up to 43,000 feet, and there it will hang and derive its lift solely from the solar heating.
Lindström has been breathing pure oxygen for 2 hours before takeoff to eradicate all the nitrogen in his bloodstream. If he didn't, the nitrogen could form bubbles at around 30,000 feet, the condition divers know well as the bends. The test capsule will be carried aloft by a new giant balloon envelope, but still just a fraction of the size of the one which will attempt the Atlantic crossing.
It's quite a feeling to see it. It's an enormous balloon. It's 10 times bigger than the first Virgin balloon, and that gives you an idea of the size. And in spite of that, it's only 1/6 of the real big one, the transatlantic balloon. It's a 400,000 cubic foot volume, which is about 8 to 10 times larger than the typical hot air balloon you see drifting across the sky. It was not our intention to fly it in anything beyond, say, 4 or 5 knots. We had a landing which was 8 knots plus, and the terrain was a bit rough, and we took a few bits off it.
It's not bad.
Oh, Christ. It's a bit faster, wasn't it?
Yes, picked up.
That's about bits outside the landing parameters.
8 knots?
You floated
10 knots?
About twice the speed limit.
Twice the speed limit, yeah,
twice
exactly.
Twice the speed limit established for this type of
equipment. You see the runway you made?
Yes, it's about 20 yards dry.
Yes, this and that much again.
Yeah. The rest of it is absolutely perfectly safe. Snapped off that bottom one, but it's very good.
We've got quite a big hammer with us.
Yeah? What do you like a panel beating? Down here. And then there's this scar across here.
Given the fact that we have achieved our test flying and we are at the end of the period where the air traffic control in Spain will allow us to fly, we decided to call today and then pull the equipment back to England to repair it.
I'm other big buildings.
I would like to extend once more to all of you a very warm welcome to Chateau Day and to this ninth Hot Air Balloon Week. I know you had a very long trip, not very easy for a lot of you, and I thank you to be here today.
In a break from the run-up to the Atlantic crossing, the Virgin team joins the elite of world balloonists in the Swiss Alps. It's a chance for fellow balloonists to swap tall tales and for Richard Branson to get some more practice in, this time over the most difficult terrain in Europe. The message is, be careful out there.
We'd just like to draw your attention to a power line at Mont Bonvent, which is a very dangerous one because the pylons are hidden in the trees on either side of the valley. It's a 60,000 volt line that crosses the valley at about 60 meters. The other obstacle here is very near the peak.
December the 26th, I'd never flown in a hot air balloon before. I've learned an awful lot since then, and it's a magnificent experience. From Per's point of view, he's had his whole life in ballooning, and in a sense, it would be a goal fulfilled. It's the ultimate challenge for anybody who is in flies for hot air balloons. Being able to say that I was the first person to cross the Atlantic in a hot air balloon is not that important.
Over dinner, the talk is of records past and risks to come.
From the very tip of St. John's to the very western shore of Ireland, as Alcott and Brown yes. did, that's a tremendous undertaking, and it's a substantial feat. But it leaves just a little nagging doubt in the back of your mind. To really cross the Atlantic by balloon, seems to me you have to go from mainland America to the UK or the European
that's
continent.
Right. The problem. Of doing that, of course, is that it is six times than anybody's been hot air balloons. And the only way that one actually will find out whether the theory works is actually to try it. And there's so many things which, in a sense, Per is actually trying, which are new. You know, everything from the pressurized capsule to the size of the balloon to the height one's traveling and so on. I mean, I actually believe the chances of success are less than perhaps people might think. I think the important thing is in life generally is to attempt things as well as you possibly can. As long as I feel that Per and I have done everything that is humanly possible, then failure is not that important.
Branson's character is a curious mix of almost studied diffidence, yet eager self-publicist. Few company profiles are as closely linked to the exploits of their chairman than Virgin to Branson's. Bicycle or balloon, there's a purpose. He still controls his leisure and entertainment empire from a London houseboat, where his first meeting today is with Chris Moss, project director of the Atlantic Attempt.
Have I got my license yet, by the way?
It's lunchtime, 1 o'clock. Lunchtime. We've got a bike ready to go and pick it up, and qualified pilot.
Mm-hmm. So I can take you through, I can teach you.
Well, yes, maybe. I think I need to get some extra insurance first.
Meet her, because Richard doesn't have to go to the society thing till 7:30.
Oh, till 7:30?
Yeah. He's got to be there at 7:30, so if Luke could pick her up. She's got three boxes of Project Yankee brochures. Right.
Elizabeth, clear the balloon file.
I say I've got to get that ordered. If it's a special blend, it may well be that there are two or three other companies involved in doing a metallized film on the back of it as well.
What if it doesn't work out?
I have to figure out something else.
they've been very helpful, haven't they?
Mm.
Tomorrow's impossible because he's not going to be in all day. If you want to call me Wednesday, I know I keep putting you off, but unfortunately there's 50 million things that Richard's doing at the moment.
It won't be ICI that actually put the metallized fabric onto the film, but they're quite sure we can get that done.
So if you want to call me Wednesday morning, I'll do everything I can to get him to see it by then.
Then they've actually got to do a special run. They've got to commission that, book the space for it, because it's a lot of fabric. We're talking about 12 miles.
All right, Jack. Thanks. Bye.
The weatherman?
We're going to make a decision on that today, yeah. It's, in fact, the most important decision, because we've got this, the chance of this American chap to come over. He is expensive, but they say he's the very best there is. Unless we get him really today, we're going to be sunk.
But an unexpected problem lay in wait for Branson. Competition.
Where Elko from Brown took off would be rather nice. Well, there are various things that need to be done about the takeoff site in Newfoundland.
Per Lindstrom's business rival, balloonist Don Cameron, who'd made an unsuccessful attempt in a gas balloon 10 years earlier, was planning to beat him to it. In secret, he too was lining up his launch site, Newfoundland.
It's the thing that's, I've always felt, is only just feasible. When we first heard that they were about to try the same thing as we had in mind, we nearly died with shock. But, and then it was a question of thinking, what do we do about it? And what we did to announce it was, I suppose, a little bit naughty.
The balloon will fly across the southwest tip of Ireland and out into southern England. The exact touchdown with accuracy. Following many months of planning, designing, and preparing for this adventure, the Virgin Transatlantic Balloon Challenge is ultimately in the hands of the pilots. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the two crew members, Per Lindstrand and Richard Branson.
Branson, what are the dangers that you'll face in the challenge?
One of the most perilous times is actually inflating the balloon. I mean, inflating something three-quarters the size of Wembley football pitch or bigger than the Albert Hall is going to need absolutely perfect conditions. And, I mean, altitude attempts in the past have often come to grief just in the inflation.
Hidden among the audience of journalists and photographers, Don Cameron waited to pounce.
What I've heard this morning makes me somewhat reluctant to throw down this gauntlet which I've been carrying around. And the reason is the decision to fly from New York. Newfoundland was the historic site of many Atlantic firsts, the Alcock and Brown flight, for example, and I've always felt that if it was good enough for them, it was good enough for me. If we can agree on a takeoff site that we both like, we'll see where we go.
Will you turn it into a race?
Anybody who wants to race this would be a very exciting thing to see happen.
Will you accommodate Mr. Cameron on the change of the takeoff site?
I think it's too early to discuss that. Yeah.
We don't really know.
Instead of contacting us, he's decided to spring it upon us 5 minutes ago. So I'd rather, you know, obviously it was something which we could consider.
Who is your co-pilot? I don't have a co-pilot.
Would you do it alone?
That's the plan at the moment.
Well, you plan to do it solo?
Yes.
Do you think they'll make it?
Or did you gate crash
it? The press conference.
Sorry?
Were you invited to the press conference today, or did you gate crash it?
What's the name of your balloon?
Sanusi. That was nearly a showstopper, the fact that they announced New York, because I considered New York to be definitely not the way to do it, because it just makes the flight a whole lot longer, about 1,000 miles longer. And since the existing hot air record is 900 miles, that's it's not a trivial addition. The other worry is carrying a highly experimental balloon over 1,000 miles of populated land areas. We're talking about something with 9 tons of propane on board.
It's got a lot of similarities.
He would not be capable of going from New York, and he stated that just the distance between New York and Newfoundland was more than a hot air balloon has ever been, which I think was actually his real reasons.
We're having put up a lot of buffeting. With this, we're going to have to be putting up with extreme temperature ranges. I've already started training for it and getting up at 6 every morning, and I'm also becoming getting tennis lessons so I can learn something else.
And I'd love to be able to go from Newfoundland, it's 1,200 miles closer. But I actually believe that most people feel that a
proper crossing of the Atlantic is from mainland America. As far as what's important in life, it doesn't matter a damn, really, which of us are first across the Atlantic. I mean, what we're suggesting now is that we literally do meet him halfway and we both take off from, say, within a mile or so of each other. We can literally turn it into a race. And we suggested that the loser pays £50,000 towards his favourite charity, or towards the winner's favourite charity.
Would you be prepared to drop down the coast a little bit?
I don't see the point. The competition is to be first across the Atlantic by hot air balloon, and having already made an Atlantic attempt which failed within sight of the coast, doesn't seem to make any sense to me to add anything onto it.
So Cameron wasn't budging. He was still going from Newfoundland. Virgin, meanwhile, accepted their own compromise and would stay in Maine.
At the moment, the race is on open rules, and there's only one rule. Whoever is the first, makes the first hot air crossing of the Atlantic is the winner.
What effect did Don Cameron's intervention have on your own test program?
Virtually nothing. We had our program laid out at an early stage, and we had plenty of work to go on with, and the method of flying and our testing and our equipment will remain the same then and now.
But Cameron's intervention meant their time was limited.
We have replaced a lot of the test flying by chamber testing. And that particular phase, which we were able to do at Burnley, did eliminate perhaps 3 weeks of test flying. This particular unit can take a simulation up to 55,000 feet and down to something like minus 80 Celsius. We only require 30,000 feet and minus 45, but that is hard enough to get, in particular a chamber that we can run an engine inside.
It's 81 now. Inlet to the supercharger, 32, and the outlet at the moment.
The engine is a crucial part of the whole machinery. It gives us the pressurization. It also gives us the power to power all the electronics on board. If we're down to our standby system, we are freezing at night and boiling during the day.
Is this the actual balloon you're going to make the crossing?
No, it's less than a tenth of the size of the big one. But it has the same skin design, where we're using a system of insulation to try to keep the heat in during the flight. And of course, we have to do computer simulations of the time that the big balloon will fly for. And to get accurate measurements for that, we're going to test the little one. The Virgin balloon is much bigger. This is necessary because it's carrying a bigger load and it's carrying it to a higher altitude. It has a pressurized capsule and the Zanussi balloon doesn't. But the Zanussi is limited to heights up to 25,000 feet. It means that you're trying to fly across the ocean between weather systems rather than jumping over them.
Cameron's press launch. Further details of his plan are unveiled. He no longer wants to go alone. His co-pilot will be Major Jim Howard, who'd been ground controller of his unsuccessful 1978 bid. Cameron also revealed how he would tackle maybe the riskiest maneuver of the entire mission, the landing, and how to prevent the enormous balloon when it comes down from dragging the capsule out of control, possibly at speed, to a serious accident.
The solution that we're going for is to use a small balloon attached to the side of the big one. And we believe we can carry out the rather difficult task of transferring the load from the big balloon, arranging that the big balloon will have its deflation vents open, and then flying off on the small one. That leaves us, as long as we do this just before the coast, leaves us with the relatively simple task of making the landfall in the small balloon.
I was quite surprised to see what they had presented as a flight proposal. It strikes an experienced balloonist as almost blatantly dangerous, extremely high risk in its concept itself.
Well, the idea is to have a balloon of about this size attached to the side of the big one. I'll just give a burn here. When we want to leave, we use the burner to heat up the small balloon, and as its lift builds up, then to gently pay out and cut loose from the big one. Of course, it's one of these things that's quite easy to say, but doing it may be another thing. We have to be very careful, of course, that it doesn't deflate on top of us, because it's a big balloon weighing half a ton. to be honest. I've heard people describe it as mad. Well, it is the most tricky part of the whole flight, and yet the problem is that there is no way of achieving a landing at the end of a flight like this that isn't tricky. The other alternative is to land with the big balloon, but you have such a massive balloon with so little payload that you're just like a piece of thistledown. You'll be inclined to blow away in any wind at all, and of course at the end of 4 days you can't guarantee what your weather will be.
Have you tested this?
No, we haven't. It's impossible to test. Although we may be able to do some tests near the ground when we, just before we go.
Balloons are large creatures with lots of inertia, and a transfer load like that between two balloons so dissimilar size is bound to be fraught with problems.
I've heard that it might even be a wind-up, that it's a deliberate ploy to make you think he's going to try it when he's going to do nothing of the kind.
It's quite possible. It is such an, as I said, untried idea that it's unlikely to be done successfully unless you really, really put a large test program and test it out thoroughly before.
Don, what's the significance of the colour black on the skin of your balloon?
The black absorbs the sun's heat and keeps it warm during the day, gives the maximum solar gain.
Why isn't the Virgin balloon using black if it's the best colour?
Well, red is quite a good colour. It will absorb most of the heat, and of course their company colours are red, so I can see why they want it red.
Well, it isn't red, in fact. It is silvery on the top and black on the bottom. In fact, on the top is silvery both inside and outside. And the reason for that is conserve heat is in the same manner as a thermos flask is silver on the inside and on the outside.
All right, well, I can see that you believe that makes sense for you, but why did you tell us it was red?
Well, it's about 3 years of work and research behind that fabric, and we didn't want to give the game away until we were ready to go.
OK. Yep.
The capsule itself is under full construction. We actually have two in a state of build on the floor, the both really identical shells, the first to be used for testing procedures, the second to be held back for the actual flight itself. And it's yet to be fitted with the electrical equipment, the navigation gear, the instruments, the gauges that read the pressurization engine. You'll see overhead the fuel valves. That's part of the burner system, and the external plumbing is on the capsule to feed the burners as well. So the fitting is coming along very nicely.
Not a lot of room for people, though.
It's very tight. The chairs are designed for reclining, for sleeping. And there is a space for sleeping on the floor as well. But a lot of work remains on the exterior of the capsule. We can show you some of that. At each point on the load frame is the attachment of the explosive bolt that accomplishes the separation of the envelope from the capsule at landing. That's an absolutely critical part to the whole flight. We found the naked capsule, if you will, without any flotation devices at all, is quite stable in the 0 degree or upright position. Try as we might to roll it over into a full inverted or upside down position, which we expected to be able to do with some ease. We, in fact, were not able to do that. So now for us, that's very good news. It's only the most dire of circumstances and under which they'll leave the capsule.
Like a fire on board or complete systems failure, in which case they might have to parachute, they'd hope, to safety. But from 30,000 feet, that means free-falling first to a height where a parachute can be deployed, and that means skydiving training. One snag, Branson has never even parachuted before.
The first few moments I was trying to keep my balance. It was okay for about 10 seconds. Then made a tremendous mistake. I let my legs drop underneath me. To my horror, I found myself tumbling towards Earth. The two trainers were trying to get to me, and one of them managed to get to my back leg. And just as he managed to get to my back leg, I managed to get hold of the ripcord and pull it. And with a great sense of relief, hurtled up into the air.
It got worse.
I then did my, by far and away, my best flight. But what I did not realize was that my hand was not going to the ripcord, it was going to the release button, which got rid of my parachute. And the instructor on my left was smiling because he could see I was doing it correctly, but he couldn't see where my hand was going to. The instructor on my right was shaking his head and trying to stop my hand, and I couldn't work out what he was meaning. In fact, I was so pleased with myself. I finally took my hand down, pulled what I thought was the ripcord. In fact, it was the cord that released the parachute. And as quick as lightning, the instructor pulled the spare chute. The spare chute came around my neck and I was hoiked off into the air. The little parachute is like the old-fashioned parachute jumping. You come down very hard and managed to land all right. Lay on the ground with a very sore and painful neck and was glad to be down to earth.
Do you think that because plans are now so far advanced for this attempt that you could pull out even if you wanted to?
Yes, I mean, I think it's much better to have a red face and pull out and give the reasons why than actually endanger one's life. As I said earlier, I'd value my life and would much rather a slight embarrassment.
So, can it be done at all? And if it can, by whom? Anthony Smith, president of the British Balloon and Airship Club.
Cameron, though he's a Scot, I think he goes for what could be called the English approach, where you seem to sort of be shambling along in a rather amateur manner, and you suddenly then pull it off at the end. Per Lindstrand, as I see it, is a man much more with checklists, who's calculated everything, he's detailed everything, he's listed everything, and he talks about things yielding at a certain strength that is put upon them. And he seems to have worked it all out. So to begin with, you start saying, well, I like the Lindstrand approach because everything has really been checked and I'm surprised if Cameron's going to get out of bed that morning. But Cameron always has been like that and has a very large number of successes to his credit.
Bobby Sparks twice failed to cross the Atlantic by helium balloon. Who does he favor?
I believe Per has probably figured this out pretty closely. I would bet on them. I believe I would bet on them, on the larger balloon and the high altitude, if they get started all right.
The man who decides when the Virgin balloon will go is their consultant meteorologist, Bob Rice, one of the world's leading weather watchers. From Rice, a warning.
One thing that you have to understand, and all people must understand, is that ballooning is dangerous. Long-distance ballooning becomes very dangerous. And it has to be understood that when a balloon flies off like this, that there is a chance that they will not come back. And it's something that you have to live with. It's something that you have to try, because that's our function, to try to avoid this. But it is a possibility.
If someone is forced to go 1 hour early or 10 minutes too late because of the race, then the whole thing becomes a carnival-type situation. And that's not really what this is.
But it's more exciting.
You're darn right. If you want to jump out of this without a parachute, you'll find it very exciting. Jump right out of this window without a parachute. It's going to be awfully exciting for a few seconds. But it isn't really the thing to do.
It's a highly technical piece of equipment. And perhaps closer to flying an aircraft than flying a balloon in the way the systems are arranged on board.
And they are individually coded.
There's no doubt the moment that balloon is airborne, you will feel very, very exhilarated.
My role at the launch site will be to be in charge of all procedures, in charge of the entire operation. I function as launch master. It's been a long, slow, painful process giving birth to this little baby balloon, and I'm going to be the one in charge of getting it into the air. The actual launch preparation is likely to begin around midnight and go through the hours of the night to have the balloon ready to fly at first light.
55 amps, and that is enough to transmit for 3 days, but on a much lower scale. There are a lot of bits and pieces. They all got to work, and they may not interact properly. Mm.
If you can get a clock.
How will you feel if you fail?
I shall manage to live for the rest of my life and get by, I'm sure. It's a game, and we'd like to win. But if we don't win, well, we'll try and be good losers.
If Don Cameron beats you to it, will you even try?
Oh, yes. We feel that we are flying from the U.S. mainland to Europe. He's flying from Canada, from the Newfoundland, which is a far shorter distance. And we still feel that there is scope for a second flight should he fly before us.
If he gets across first, we'll still have a great challenge, and it'll still be an incredible experience. And I'll still be able to sit my grandchildren on my knee and say, we're the second people across the Atlantic. The big question mark is whether either of us are going to get across. That's the real question, not whether one of us are going to win.